I'd like to begin by introducing Christine Darcy, who is a speech pathologist with DECD, but is employed at Seaford Secondary College 4 days a week to work in partnership with leaders, teachers and staff in general to support intervention and guidance and pedagogical response for students with identified language disorder or disability. Merryn Gomez, Learning Support Assistant Principal currently at Eastern Fleurieu, previously at Seaford Secondary College, and the two people here have really trailblazed some really exciting work in this area.
I'd just like to start by saying thank you for this opportunity to present our collective story to you. And I just want to do some acknowledgements before we get underway to acknowledge colleagues Tim Kittle and Rose Zadel, who are speech pathology colleagues who are part of this journey. But they were in the earlier part, but they are very much embedded in our story today. So we're going to be covering language development, language for literacy and secondary learning, what is language impairment, language impairment and how it impacts on literacy, mental health, behaviour and youth offending, why speech pathologists in secondary schools, we hopefully will answer that for you, and then we're going to share stories from sites. So the Seaford Secondary College and Eastern Fleurieu stories. We'll recap with some of the challenges of language impairment and how we might respond to those challenges. So just to set the scene, I'm just going to very quickly, this is 101 language development for you. So typically the course of language development sees us developing our understanding before our ability to produce language, and we learn to talk before we can learn to write. And these are some of the components of language development. It's a bit of a summary. So vocabulary, that's all the words we know, simple and deep knowledge as we progress throughout the course of language development from 0 to 18. Grammar, simple to more complex sentence structures, inferencing, the ability to read between the lines. Social communication, using language to navigate social interactions with others, manage conflicts. Discourse, being able to use language to have a conversation to explain, describe, and explain what we mean. So language is important for accessing the curriculum. And the kind of language we need is more complex than the language of conversation. It's not enough to have a basic grasp of conversational language to access the curriculum and the demand, particularly the demands of the secondary curriculum. Language for literacy means good spoken and written, really robust vocabulary, sentence, grammar, and narrative and expressive language skills. So this is just a summary of the different types of language we need for secondary school learning. So the language becomes more abstract, inferential, analytical. We use language to reason and problem solve. We need to understand figurative language, interpret idioms, metaphors and proverbs. We need to use our social language so we can switch between formal and informal situations and knowing when to do that. To interact with the peer group for our young adolescents, to grasp slang and sarcasm and how to joke and make innuendos and have opinions and discuss, share arguments and debates. We use language in adolescence for written expression and also the language for secondary learning involves a more academic vocabulary. So the complexity of language is much higher in summary. And also the instructional language in the secondary classroom really ramps up and becomes a lot more complex as some of the words that are listed there are often embedded in instructions within worksheets, assignments, and the teacher's oral instructional language. So what is language impairment? Well, there's a lot of debate at the moment. So there was a recent roundtable discussion with a panel of experts around Australia talking about it. And I'm just going to quickly show you the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Health Disorders version of how they classify language. They actually call it language disorder, and there's not consensus yet on how we label it or identify it or classify it. But I'll just show you that technical version, and now I'm going to show you a student's perspective, and Merryn's going to introduce that for you, a student's perspective of what language impairment is.
So you're about to see a little girl, year seven girl, Leah, describe what she believes language impairment is. And what you'll see when you're watching that is, I guess, the typical representation that we see. Leah is probably more articulate and has a better vocab than most students with language impairment, so bear that in mind when she's describing what it is as well.
Language impairment is, like, it's kind of hard to explain, but, it's sort of like it's harder to understand your own language, I guess. Yeah.
So most of the research into the prevalence of language impairment and communication problems has been based on younger children. A recent study I can refer you to is one that was in New South Wales a couple of years ago. 14,000 Catholic school students in just one diocese in New South Wales showed an average of 11% of students across the secondary school years were identified with some form of communication disorder. And the ABS, Australian Bureau of Statistics, for 2006 suggested in an average secondary school of 538 students, about 59 students would have a problem with their communication skills.
How common is language impairment? We know that it's highly inheritable, and what we've found across the two sites that I've worked at with Christine is that this is certainly the case. When we've verified a sibling with language disorder, the parents will often say, well, hang on a minute, I've got two more kids and they're exactly the same. And on further investigation, yeah, it turns out they are. So we've certainly seen that. It's just as common as childhood obesity. Affects as many as one in five children. It's a part of other conditions such as autism spectrum disorder, hearing impairment, specific learning difficulty and intellectual disability. And it's especially prevalent in socially disadvantaged communities. So if you think about the different DEP sites that you work with and you think about where they sort of stand with their social disadvantage and how many students there are, and you look at that one in five children, that's pretty powerful. I know the site I'm working at the moment, that would mean that there's at least 70 students there that have difficulty with communication and language, and we certainly haven't identified that many yet, so we've got a long way to go. And why oral language development should be the top priority and integrated into the curriculum from preschool to secondary school. And that's what we've got an opportunity to look at and to move forward and do now. So what does it actually look like for a young person who has a language impairment? Now, this slide here is a collection of statements made by young people with language impairment, taken from the SLI handbook, produced by UK-based charities ICAN and Aphasic, who are focused on supporting children and young people with communication needs in the UK. And I'm just going to point out four of them that I certainly found significant and important to focus on. And one of them is the first one there. I struggle with reading and writing. Most of the students that we've come across who've been verified with language impairment have a lot of difficulties with reading and writing. They may or may not have gone through reading intervention programs in their junior primary and primary years, and if they have, they may or may not have engaged with it or been successful. So students coming into secondary school, we can't assume that they do have those basic skills of reading and writing because they often don't. I don't understand what lots of words mean, so they really struggle with the vocab and the comprehension, and that obviously affects, along with the reading, pretty much everything they do in the classroom. I might have behavioural problems and get frustrated or withdrawn. And one that's really, really important that I'd like to focus on is I'm quite smart, so even though I don't understand the words, I watch so I know what's going on. So often they've learned throughout primary school as the way to get by is look at what everyone else is doing. So when you see that kid in the classroom who might be copying the kid next to them, we need to think of that as a behaviour as well and what that's communicating. Okay, which leads us on to how does it actually feel to have a language impairment? So in your little packs, you should have a piece of paper that looks like this house. So if you could grab that out, you're about to experience what it's like in the classroom for a student with language impairment every single lesson of every single day. Okay, so if you're all organised now, if you could complete the house by following these oral instructions. Number one, draw a dorm door. Come on, get on with it.
Oh.
A dorm door. Draw a dorm door. Why aren't you doing anything? I've already said the instruction twice. Tim, what's the matter? Why aren't you doing your work?
I've finished.
Okay, could you go and stand at the back, please? Number two. Excuse me. I'm still speaking. Number two. Draw two thingies up the door. Do you want me to say that again? Draw two thingies, bop the door. I said bop the door. Are you ready for the next one? Excellent. Number three, draw a little hand sick the door.
Can't you hear it?
What was that again?
Draw a little hand sick the door. I shouldn't need to repeat this a number of times. You should all be listening. And we went through this last lesson. You should be prepared for this. Number four, draw a shower window, knock the door. And number five, draw a tree, win the house. Okay, and you should be done in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Could you please hold up your work? That is not what I asked you to do at all.
No, very good.
So have a little laugh, have a look at the ones next to you if you like. And if we bring up the next slide. So this is what all of those words actually meant.
A big door.
So did you do a big door?
Yes.
Did you do two windows beside the door?
I thought they were decorative.
Did you do a little handle on the door?
Yes.
You are.
This is the gifted group.
But what you could see as you were doing the activity, you could see that, you know, I was saying things that you didn't understand and those words didn't make any sense to you. And there was you know, some people laughing, some sort of looking around going, what, did I not hear that right? What am I supposed to be doing? And all sorts of behaviours. And they're the behaviours that we see in the classroom when students are not understanding what the instruction is.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, you can.
You said it's hereditary or can be. So is this nature or nurture? Is this about kids just not having had the experience? Or is it that...
It's a combination of many factors, and you can have a predisposition and a familial predisposition to language impairment. We know there's a strong familial link, but that can be exacerbated by an impoverished learning environment pre-coming to school or the education experience. So there's been research that's looked at the vocabulary development in different socioeconomic groups, and how that impacts on how many words and the types of conversations parents have with children
leading up to the emergent literacy phase, which is preschool. So yes, the two interact.
And that's a really good question and a really good link into the importance of looking at the whole curriculum and right back to the early years learning framework all the way through to, you know, the secondary curriculum and what we can learn from each other from that as well. But thinking about that activity, some of the things, you know, the people laughing, that could be the kid in the class that's seen as the class clown, watching or copying next year's, the kid that we look at as the kid cheating in the classroom, losing interest or talking to the person next year's, the one that's disrupting all the other kids. So we really need to think about that when we're in the classroom and we see these behaviours, what are those behaviours telling us, rather than just, why is that kid ruining this awesome lesson I've created? So now that you've done that activity and you know what it might feel like to have a language impairment, think about the fact that 80 to 90% of the secondary curriculum is delivered via teachers' spoken and written language. So we are pretty well talking about every lesson of every day that they're struggling with this.
So now I'd like you to take your new experience of language impairment with you as we explore the impact of language impairment on literacy and other factors. So firstly, I'd like to acknowledge the work of senior speech pathology colleague Sue McCandish and the DECD Talking Literacy Project's work, which is embedded in these next few slides. So this graphic is called, referred to as the literacy wall. And it's a representation of how oral language underpins the transition to literacy. So the oral language are the foundation blocks down the bottom. And oral language really does underpin the transition to literacy because learning to read is a language-based task. Strong oral language skills promote the transition and further development of literacy skills, and they also support the development and transition from learning to read to reading to learn. So this is what the literacy wall looks like when you've got language impairment. Without strong oral language skills, the foundations of the wall become unstable and skill gaps start to appear. And a young person can't transition from learning to reading to learn. So that's a graphic representation of what's happening to a lot of the young people that we're working with in the secondary setting. And it happens over time. So I'm just going to share with you some research on reading development now, which is reported on the fourth grade slump reading development, and it's particularly relevant to children in lower socioeconomic groups who, in a study by Chow et al., achieved, as well as children from middle and upper income families in years 2 and 3, but then their scores started to fall in years 3 and 4. And were showing clear gaps in their reading abilities. And by year 7, they were 2 years behind their peers. And why? Well, the assessments that they did show that vocabulary is one of the first areas to slide. And you can see how important knowing what words mean is from having done that house activity with us. I'll just share a bit of research into vocabulary development now. That's indicated that although the reading development of children starts to decline in year 4, the vocabulary differences in children are evident before that time. One study of year 2 children showed their vocabulary differed by as much as 4,000 words between the top 25% and the bottom 25%. In the research group, and this trend continued for children in years 3, 4, 5 and 6. The take-home message there is that the lowest achievers did not catch up.
And to sum up that research, the rich get richer and the poor get poorer, resulting in significant negative outcomes for children with these difficulties.
One thing that we've certainly seen in the schools that I've worked in is the impact of language impairment on mental health. One of the negative outcomes correlated with language impairment we know is poorer mental health. So Christine is now going to go through how that links in specifically with secondary school students.
So this graphic illustrates the reciprocal relationship between language competence and mental health. And if we follow the arrows to the right, good oral language skills lead to the acquisition of a flexible repertoire of social skills, association with like peers, positive self-esteem, mastery and control of your life. If we take the left-hand side, oral language competency supports the transition to literacy. Academic success, strong school attachment reinforces positive self-esteem, leads to school retention, completion, and access to post-secondary education. But if you have a language impairment, then there's a very good chance that you'll have poor mental health. And the study by Barrett there illustrates that someone with a language impairment is highly likely to experience one of those mental illnesses listed there. And more specifically, related to the adolescent population, another study of inpatients in the Victorian Stepping Stones Adolescent Psychiatric Inpatient Unit found 57% of young people diagnosed with language disorder were in that unit, and 80% of them had never consulted with a speech pathologist before. So they'd gone throughout primary school and some of secondary school and never had it detected. So it's it just reinforces to us that it is a hidden problem.
This is my favourite part of the presentation because I think back to about 7 years ago when I met this beautiful woman next to me and her saying to me, behaviours communication, and thinking, what is she on about? I don't even know what that means. So the journey that we went on, you know, after that conversation has certainly cleared that up for me. And I think it's something that is just, it's so important for as educators, as leaders, for us to understand, because most of the conversations that my teaching staff and my SSO staff have with me are about behaviour. You know, this kid's doing this in my class and we need to talk to the parents, we need to do that, but we don't often take the time to stop and say, well, what is that behaviour communicating? What does it mean? What's behind it? And what can we do to support that student and to really understand that? So language impairment also has a reciprocal relationship with behaviour. All human behaviour can be considered a form of communication, and that can be difficult for the non-language impaired person to understand and interpret. Students who have difficulty understanding and using language for learning and interacting socially often exist in a state of ambiguity, which can result in anxiety and challenging behaviours, and that's the sort of behaviours that we're seeing in the classroom. So you imagine these kids showing up to school every day, and when they're arriving, they're already at that heightened state of anxiety, and then they have to try and follow instructions that they don't understand and are being constantly sent out of the classroom, so they're spending more time disengaged with the curriculum. It can be really challenging for them. And even as adults, we can, I'm sure, all remember a time when we've experienced the fight, flight, freeze response, when we've felt overwhelmed, and that's often where these behaviours are coming from. So while the language impairment you might be hidden, what you might see in the classroom is a student that is labelled as naughty or unteachable, lazy, forgetful, not listening, withdrawn. The extroverts might come across as the class clowns, a can think of about 10 of them right now that I've taught this week. Disruptive or disorganised, they don't start work or hand in work. And these behaviours can easily be misinterpreted and result in timeouts, suspensions, exclusions, which are all things that are, I guess, enhancing those behaviours in a way, because they're disengaging the student even more from their connection with the school and often being sent to different sites for better behaviour programs and learning centres. So the language impaired student becomes increasingly at risk of misunderstanding, disempowerment, disengagement from school, poor academic outcomes, and as we've gone through, poor mental health.
So I just wanted to share with you some data that was collected by colleagues in the Southern Adelaide and Murray Mallee regions a couple of years ago. And they looked at referrals to the Interagency Behaviour Support Consultant, now the Behaviour Coaches. And they found that 40 to 50% of those referrals, of those students, had had prior speech pathology involvement. And the data suggested that that problem was consistent across regions, and that there was a large unidentified need and potential support required for secondary students. And guess what? Language impairment is also highly correlated with young offenders. A study by Putnam in 1999 showed that a staggering 80% of juvenile offenders had been suspended or excluded from school on at least one occasion. And those that had a severe degree of language impairment were more likely to commit a violent crime as opposed to a property-based crime, because they didn't have the language, language and reasoning skills to be able to plan for a property-based crime as opposed to a very reactive physical based crime. So another very sobering piece of information. And thank you, Renee. In another study by Snow and Powell of South Australian offenders with a mean age of 19, 46, almost one in two, were identified with a severe language impairment. Previously undetected. So, yep, we might just come back to this slide depending on how much time we have, but if we don't get back to it, I really encourage you to go to that link, and the ABC 730 report did an expose on language disorders and young people in the youth justice system in Victoria, and some work they're doing there, and how speech pathologists are supporting those young offenders, and the impact of language impairment on the outcomes for our young people. It's also important we keep in mind language impairment in our Indigenous youth, because of their high rate of middle ear infection in this population that impacts on their early language development. In addition to that, for many of them, English is an additional language. And then you have the added complexity of standard versus school English. So we talked earlier about the difference between literate language and conversational language. And of course, they're overrepresented in our youth justice system. So for every 1,000 Indigenous youth, 44 are represented in the justice system as opposed to 3 per 1,000 non-Indigenous. I just thought we'd end this section with this cartoon, which Lucy and Linus really sum up really well the relationship between behaviour and communication there. I'll give you a moment to read it. So
So why have speech pathologists in secondary schools? This question takes me back to the start of the journey, I guess, for me, which was sitting in a SRT meeting in 2010 or 2011, and I had a year seven student who just started at the school, Drew, and he was showing all the signs of language impairment. He ticked every box. He'd never been referred before for a language assessment throughout primary school, so I brought him up at the table, said, really like a language assessment, and was told, no, you're a secondary site, even though he was still in year seven, so technically could have argued it, but you're a secondary site, so you don't have access. A family who didn't have the capacity to get that assessment themselves, so I potentially had a student who was going to go the rest of his schooling with no assessment when I knew there was something more to his story that we didn't understand. So for me, that answers that question, why we need them there. They're always going to be kids who slip through the cracks, regardless of what we do in primary school. And this slide really does illustrate the why. If you skip with Dylan to the 11 to 14 years, he's already avoiding school. His speech is usually clear, but vocab's limited, and language is poor, struggles to read and write, misbehaves in class until sent out, and is known at school as difficult. And that was certainly what the feedback from the teachers were for this student I was talking about. So the challenge that we were faced with was that we had limited access, or at the time no access, to a deaf speech pathologist.
And that's because historically deaf speech pathology services have been focused on the early years, preschool to year two. But more recently, there's been a body of research that's telling us it's really important to continue to offer a service to older students, because what we've learned from that research is that language impairment is often a lifelong disability, and the course of the language impairment and what it looks like can change over time. So even a mild language impairment diagnosed in preschool or reception can grow and become a severe language impairment by adolescence. And so young people that were identified in the early years may not have seen a speech pathologist again, and they might have been identified as having an impairment and a response was provided, but then it wasn't possible to follow up. And we now know that that can change over time, so it's even more important that we continue to monitor their development over the course of their schooling from preschool to secondary school. So now I'm going to hand you over to Cez and talk about how the Seaford Secondary College responded to that challenge.
I think it's such an important story to share, and hopefully, I mean, we're in the most amazing position in learning improvement, in that we can support and affect change right across South Australian DECD schools. So in 2012, the learning observations, 48% of students in year 7 and 9 were below benchmark in aspects of literacy and or numeracy. And it's really important to say that there were many leaders and teachers really providing deep focus and commitment to improving outcomes for all students across Seaford. But flow was a distraction. When you look at 945 students in the school and 220 of them in flow, it was a big, like a critical mass. And it took students away from that learning environment. 14 students at the end of 2011 received an ATAR. Several students arriving at Seaford at year 7 and 8 demonstrated very low school level in literacy and numeracy. Many could not access the curriculum. And several students exhibiting poor behaviour basically were referred to flow. So the behaviour, it was a well-being response and an automatic response. At this time, so in 2012, there was some really interesting research being undertaken in the area of language disorders within the juvenile justice system. And that research undertaken in the UK, but also in Victoria. And there was some interesting data being collected around young offenders,
and silent, undiagnosed language disorder. And for me, the alignment of what I was experiencing at Seaford and seeing in the community in relation to the presenting behaviours and the verified language impairment and what research was highlighting, for me it was just like this absolute sledgehammer. At the same time, I had this flamboyant speech pathologist by the name of Tim Kittle. I don't know if any of you have come across Tim, but he had begun his own research on this, and he happened to be aligned to Seaford as part of support services. So he had to do this thing where, and I don't know a lot about this, but he talked about the fact that he had this clerical job to do every year called case closure. So the first 3 years there is access to speech pathology for very early reception year 1-2 students. At the end, the speech pathology ends at the end of that time. And a clerical task of going through the department data system and case closing afterwards. So he was doing this work around about the time that the research was occurring in the UK and in Victoria. And every time he pushed case closure, this pop-up would come up. So this is years after. So the kids are sort of year 7, year 8, year 9. And every case, so there, it, a pop-up would say there is ongoing service, so you can't case close. The case close, the ongoing service was around behaviour intervention. So he's doing this process and thinking this is really interesting, and began collecting the data around it and found this incredible alignment with students that had had intervention with speech pathology in the very early years of their schooling and poor behaviour choices later in schooling. And that began his little, research and alignment with some of the work that was happening overseas and interstate around language impairment. He shared this work with me as part of an SRT meeting at Seaford, and we joined forces. It just seemed like the perfect partnership. So, as a result, I employed Tim Kittle 0.2 at Seaford to assess students with a possible language disorder, provide strategies for teachers of students identified with language disorder, and to work in classrooms and with students in the flow to support their learning. So the actions, employed a speech pathologist. So first of all, it was Tim Kittle. Then he became a principal speech pathologist, and Rose Zanol joined our team, and then Christine Darcy. And it's so fascinating because over those years, our learning around language impairment and the strategies and the need have evolved. We undertook a really, really deep analysis of flow students in 2012, all 220 of them, and really looked closely at their learner profile. And with that, 11% of students had a non-verbal IQ in the gifted range, 48% of students had a verified disability, 8% had a mental health plan, 43% had learning difficulty of some form and no referral to support services. So we began this little investigation or adventure at Seaford, where every single student that was suspended for demonstrating any form of violence, whether that be physical or verbal, was referred to Tim. Also, students demonstrating disengagement through poor attendance or learning difficulties, we really, really worked hard to have them referred and assessed. As a result of this process, a really high number of students were verified with a language disorder. Another really important part of this story is around young offenders. So in the Seaford area, there were a high percentage of students who were repeat offenders. So around about the time I began at Seaford, so too did we have a new neighbourhood police officer by the name of Matt Round. And we worked really closely together in learning about language impairment. And what I applied and worked with our leaders within Seaford, he applied and worked with the young offenders in the community. And it was sort of amazing. Those of you who have been involved in leadership in any site where you follow an exclusion process, we actually had permission for every exclusion where there was a child who was engaging in violence, physical mainly. Matt was with us. So he was there as part of the police presence. What we did is created a different way of working with young offenders in the community. Rather than, it sounds terrible because I have so many stories, rather than chase them, actually do an ID, go to their home, wait with the families for them to get home, and then Matt would talk to them. So it totally changed the way that SAPOL worked. And in 2014 and in 2015, not one repeat offender from Seaford Secondary College, not one. So if they're done once for shoplifting, once for break and entry, whatever, they have never repeated. That's sort of exciting. So 2015, verifications, and many more potential verifications, but there were simply only so many days in the year. So a high number of students arriving at Seaford in year 7 and 8 continue to be verified with a language or learning disability or a language disorder, 15 in 2015. This has been a consistent pattern over the past 2 years. Student growth post-diagnosis and intervention in the areas of literacy and numeracy is significantly higher than in years preceding the diagnosis and intervention. So the key points, and I'll finish off. Understanding that presenting behaviour is communicating a learning need for many students. Build into all you do those high standards and expectations and aspiration, and target intervention based on learning need, or that learner profile. So there were a number of moments that took my breath away, and I'm going to share those with you, and some of them I shared with the staff at the beginning of the year. I saw a change in the body, the cohort of students at Seaford. I remember walking out on yard duty last year, and I counted 143 students playing sport on the oval. So these are the little moments, which might not mean much to you sitting in the room, and probably to Christine and Merryn, you will understand. That was so exciting. Playing sport because they wanted to, and really proud of that. Year 7's playing chasey. Students nearly bowling me over at recess time one day to tell me of their reading growth. Building aspirations in students, where I would hear them talking about becoming astronauts or doctors. Looking over at a student during a meeting with Tim, so this is very early days, where he had brought in the parents, key leaders, discussing the qualities of language impairment. And I looked over at this year 10 boy, and I could see this great big pool of water, and there was a moment that I thought he'd knocked over his glass of water, and he was crying. And he said, "That's me." And that was prior to sharing that the results of the assessment. We had a whole school musical in 2015, and we now have drama in year 12 in 2016. The year 9 camera trip, which happens annually, has a waiting list. And in November last year, the manager of Big W, which is across the road from a school, and anyone who's been in a school where there's a shopping centre next door, it's a nightmare, rang me to say that Seaford Secondary College was their preferred site for students to be employed.
So around the same time that Cez had employed Tim Kittle, I think it was in his first year there, and for those who have met Tim will understand this completely, I had heard about, so I just had the SRT meeting. In fact, I think I had two more where I'd asked for a language assessment again and had been shut down. So I was on a mission to get this kid an assessment, and I'd heard what they were doing at Seaford. So I visited, and I was meeting with one of the leaders there, and all of a sudden Tim wafted into the room, and did this big spill about language impairment and a student who we just assessed and what they were going to do about it. And he walked out and I said, who is he and how do I get one of them? Because that's what I need. And that's what led us to being able to employ Christine back at Eastern Fleurieu School then. And the next slide is, and there's two case studies, but I'm just going to go through one of them quickly. So this is actually the student I was talking about in the SRT meeting, and he was the very first student who Christine assessed. So he'd had ongoing behaviour issues on transition to Year 7, and all of his transition notes said, behaviour problem in the classroom, distracting other students, don't put in with pretty much the entire list of Year 7 students who were also transitioning. We did his formal language assessment, and he came out with a severe language disorder and a verification, so we could get him onto a negotiated education plan and finally get him the support that he really needed. It gave staff an understanding around that behaviours communication and not looking at him as his disengagement and as his challenging behaviour, but looking at him and what could we do to support him and what can we do differently in the classroom as well. So that really impacted his schooling. He's in year 11 now and he has a transition plan for it to go on to further study after he finishes school, and he is 100% on track and will be achieving that. So this was potentially the difference for him from moving on into the scenario that Cez described earlier. So I guess a lifetime of, you know, possibly unemployment and welfare and disengagement and crime to being able to contribute positively to society and access the supports that he needs. So it really is for these students a last chance, and it's so important. And I look back when I need a bit of a reality check when I was at Seaford and Christine had verified 21 students, and it sort of started to become just a number to me, and it wasn't, I was thinking, oh, yeah, 22, let's go for 22. You know, there's got to be more of them. And I think back to when she, and I get a bit emotional about this one, so I'm really sorry. I think back to when I was in the room and she was reading to me his language assessment, and I made her read out every word and describe it to me. And just, I guess, thinking about the impact that had on his life was really grounding for me. And I reflect on that regularly when I need that reality check. So moving on to 2014, I started at Seaford Secondary College and saw the need very quickly that we needed to increase the speech pathology time, because there was still so many students out there that were presenting with these behaviours, that were disengaging with school, struggling to access the curriculum or even be present in a classroom and be able to regulate their own emotions because they were so anxious, I guess, to be at school. So we continued a focus on identification and increased Christine's time to 0.8 in 2016, which allowed us to then provide more support to staff and continue on that journey as well as the assessment and verification journey.
So I'm just going to share last year's data with you and some of the learning that came from that. So the focus on the speech pathology service in 2015 was on assessment, so providing an assessment service and identifying students with a language impairment and offering staff support and advice on intervention strategies and options for them. So of 35 assessments, 29 were from DECD primary schools. Of that 29, only 13 had ever been referred to a speech pathologist. Of those that went on to be diagnosed with a language impairment, which was 26 out of that 35. 17 were diagnosed with a severe language impairment and eligible for a negotiated education plan. And closely behind the severes were 7 moderates and 2 milds. If we look at the disability type data, so 26 language impaired,
We also looked at their reading skills, and 24 of those 26 also had a reading impairment. So that supported the correlation the research was telling us about between language impairment and reading problems.
I just want to tell you about this one here. This little girl, so she came to us in Seaford in year seven, never been referred to anything, any support services before at all. She was flipping tables in classrooms, biting students. Her behaviours were so extreme. She just could not manage in a classroom setting. She could not read, she couldn't spell, she could barely write, and never been referred before. So clearly we bumped her quite quickly to the top of the list to be assessed, and she's now, after a lot of negotiating and trying different strategies, she's actually now in the special unit at Christie's Beach High School. So not only did she get diagnosed with language impairment and an intellectual disability, she also met the criteria for special options, not just special class, special unit. So that's huge.
And that just shows that 12 were severe language impaired only. Two also were diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder. And the one that Merryn just talked to you about had the severe language impairment as well as an intellectual disability. And six were diagnosed with autism.
Those who were severe?
Yes.
Are you saying, did I hear you say before that a language impairment could change over time? So is it possible that it wasn't severe earlier?
Yes. Yes, it's very possible that they had mild difficulties that went undetected, and then as the demands of the curriculum increased, their limited skill set could not keep pace with the increasing language demands of the curriculum, and the gap widened for them, most definitely.
I think what's going through my mind is sometimes in preschool we might refer children and they will meet the criteria for some support. Then the criteria changes when they go to primary school and they're no longer eligible for support. So that just sounds amazing.
What also happens sometimes is a child might be referred in preschool or junior primary, and they might get intensive support. They might even get a negotiated education plan. And while they're getting that support, life's amazing because they need that intervention. But then,
and they can improve themselves.
Yeah, exactly. Support. But then what happens is that support stops, and then the gap widens. And by the time they get to secondary school,
that's where the behaviour kicks in, the case closure.
Yeah, exactly.
But sometimes the support stops because they no longer qualify for it.
Exactly, yes.
And sometimes in schools, teachers might jump up and down and say, I'm really concerned about this child. But the process to go through, like there might be five other kids that are worse in the school. So look, that child, there's no way that child's going to get a good.
So the two reinforce one another.
Yeah, you're right. And that's, as an educator, that's heartbreaking because, you know, you tell the parent, I'm going to do whatever I can, and then what if, for whatever reasons, they're telling you there's no point because they're not bad enough. You go back to the parent and say, I'm really sorry, I tried. And, you know, you're caught between a rock and a hard place. So
my answer is we need to change the process.
Yeah. It's really devastating. Yeah.
And this is where I think we can trailblaze some of those changes. I know that within a large secondary school, which is quite different to a smaller site, we could see there were verifications waiting to be had. So we paid for our own person to undertake those verifications, and the money sustained the position. So that, you know what I mean? So you can be creative within a site. The bigger question that you are highlighting, that we, many of us, are living that dream, is the system, we've got to change that part because the need far outweighs the support, and that is impacting directly on engagement and on learning. So it's really challenging.
And a lot of small sites don't have the...
That's what I said. So, you've got the advantage in a large secondary size, but not in smaller.
And that was sort of the next step. At Seaford, we brought the River Hub Partnership along, and that's continued this year in a shared journey with Christine leading as speech path.
So what did we learn from the data from 2015? Was clearly that we needed to get better at identifying language impairment so that we could provide intervention as soon as possible. And as you've touched on just then, as a secondary site, but also the opportunity that's there as partnerships now to be able to work together on that. And the benefits of improving detection of language impairment is that the site and teacher can intervene sooner. I think also it increases parent awareness and support. A lot of our parents don't know what to look for, and by the time they get to secondary school, they also believe that their kid just has a behaviour problem. So it's a real learning process and a real journey for them as well.
I was just wondering, this is sort of outside, obviously we're going to go on with what we can do as teachers, but with all of this data starting to be collected, is there going to be a set of ads about vocabulary for parents that, you know, a bit like super ads where this child reads and kids going up through a system and this child doesn't? Is there any plans for anything like that?
This is our work. This is our opportunity.
Yeah, is there any way we can get... Because to me, fantastic that we're going to, you know, obviously there are things we can do, but if we can hit the root source, which is, you know, you hear parents go, I'm too busy, I can't read to my kids, whereas that's actually probably the one thing they can do and skip, you know, half a dozen other things to help them in further life. You know, I could see a series of ads and, you know, kids looking up, what's vocabulary mean on Kindle and a dictionary? Mm-hmm.
Creative ideas. Keep them coming. So the other benefit of improving detection is... hopefully we can quantify the real level of language disability in the student population. And the other advantage is we can steer families and children who are identified with a language impairment to access, in addition to the supports available in their school, to external supports that are provided now by the NDIS, Medicare rebated therapy sessions under a GP management plan, and mental psychology counselling sessions that are available under a mental health care plan.
So we realised at Seaford that we needed to come up with a plan to improve the identification of students with language impairment, and we needed to really involve teachers from the start of that process. So we came up with the concept of implementing a language screening test that could be done by teachers to help improve the identification process. So this is the process we went with here, where the teacher raises the concern with the speech pad. We tried to make it so that as much as we could was electronic, so that could be done by email. The teacher then completes a electronic checklist, sends it on to the speech path, who decides whether or not a screening test is appropriate, and then arranges the screening test. So that it needs to be, SSOs are not able to be doing it, it needs to be a teacher or a speech and language path who's trained in that.
So our process is teacher raises concern, we respond very quickly with the checklist they complete. That results in a screening test. If they fail, we intervene and refer. And even if they pass, we still look at the information that we collected on the test, because sometimes there are specific skill gaps and we'd still like to respond to those so we can offer strategies to the classroom teachers for those students, e.g. they had particularly weak skills on sentence construction, and that's going to impact across their ability to demonstrate their learning in writing. So the screening test is the SELF-4 screening test, and it stands for Clinical Evaluation of Language Fundamentals, 4th edition. It's $700 delivered. It's normed on Australian and New Zealand students. Simple scoring system of the 0 or a 1. There's a criterion score for our age group. It's 22 or 23, you pass or fail. Takes teachers 15 to 20 minutes to administer it, so you can very quickly identify whether there's a likely to be a language impairment present.
and respond to that. It takes about 2.5 hours to train the teachers. And so the screening test for language impairment is a really time and cost efficient response. And that's just an example of the test form. So the teachers there has given me some comments and feedback on how the student presented and approached the test. They needed a score of 22 to pass, they got 18. So they referred to me. I have a look at their responses inside the sheet because the test is for 5 to 21 year olds. So it can be used in reception through to year 12. And we've in the partnership, we've trained 21 of the primary teachers across the various primary school sites. And we're collecting data at the moment to look at the correlation between their score the students achieve on the screening test and when they go on to have further language assessment by the speech pathologist, how big a language impairment they had to help us in the future to triage and prioritise those students more likely to, you know, have significant language impairment based on their score on the screening test, so we can respond quickly. And this is one of our teachers that we trained, talking about the screening test and her reflections.
When I went through the training, it opened my eyes to the different processes that everyone goes through with their language in terms of constructing it to communicate. And when I was actually doing students with the test, I found that when I was marking through the test, it gave me quite a good understanding of those components and identified where the students were having difficulty. So it made me think about different ways that I could incorporate activities to develop those skills for all the students in my class. In my own classrooms, I'm incorporating the learning goals and I'm incorporating the vocabulary and videos with the vocabulary and getting the kids to do little quick tests and card work to help them develop that experience with the language and then putting it into practice. Just little things like that have started to, I guess, shape how I approach the concepts that I'm teaching, because I strongly believe that they need to have the same curriculum as their peers. So I'm not going to, dumb down the curriculum for them in that way, because I want them to be able to be successful at the next year level and not be behind. So I always look at maybe starting them younger, but with the curriculum and stepping them up, but trying to take them through so that they understand it and can make stronger connections and links. When I do these different activities in the classroom, I do find that all the students are more engaged. Certainly the more able students grasp it a little bit quicker, and I have them going, "Oh, I understand that now," and it's really nice to have them go from the surface knowledge and more into the deeper knowledge that they're actually getting to enjoy and see, especially in the mathematics, get to enjoy the concepts that are there and see the beauty of maths rather than just, "Oh, this is what we're doing again and I don't get it." Now they're actually getting to the stage where they're going, "Oh, yep, I've got it right, I know what I'm doing." So it's really, it's nice as a teacher to have that feedback from them.
That's just a visual representation of the process after the screening test and how we respond if they pass or fail, which I've already explained to you. And as I said, my speech pathology colleagues in the Rehab Partnership have worked with me on providing the training to teachers across the partnership in the use of the screening test.
So very quickly, 62% of those screened have failed. And those that went on to have a formal language assessment, 100% of them were diagnosed with a language impairment. And 55% of those were severe, and the rest, the other piece of the pie, was actually shared by the mild and moderates. So the other learning from the data was that, we didn't want to just keep focusing on assessing and identifying, but we wanted to increase the site's capacity to support the students we were finding with language impairment. And but first we had to acknowledge some challenges. Ever-increasing timetable, you can't provide a traditional clinical 30-minute speech therapy session in a secondary setting for all those reasons. As young people get older, there's a real stigma attached with coming out of class to work with someone like me. There's the further disadvantage of lost learning time, many teachers across different subjects with different teaching styles, having to quickly change from one classroom to another, and needing to have all of these skills, which they very often have in limited quantities, and remembering 80 to 90% of the secondary curriculum is delivered by the teacher's spoken and written language.
So we're going to show you a little video now, the extended version of the interview with Leah, who you met earlier, explaining what language impairment was. So this is her story so far. So she's 13 years old, she's in year 8. Parental concern about Leah's learning was expressed during her primary school years. History of suspensions, social and behaviour issues throughout her whole schooling. Did not achieve national or school average for NAPLAN ever across any components or year levels. During her assessment, she reported that she struggled with her learning and had really bad anxiety when entering the school car park. Never referred to DECD support services and verified with severe language impairment and an NEP in 2016.
Well, it was pretty scary to come to school because I was scared that everyone was going to judge me. And I didn't really like not being like everyone else.
Content. On some occasions she would be teary, couldn't cope, couldn't even walk in the class. Other times she'd be disruptive and made the learning environment for the whole class quite difficult. Leah would often demonstrate rudeness when she didn't understand the work, was not willing to participate in any learning activity, mainly because she thought she could not even start it or access the content.
Oh, I felt like I kept on like getting in trouble because the teachers thought I was refusing to do the work. But I wasn't really refusing, I just couldn't do it. But I guess I won't get one of the jobs that I wanted because they look at your, like, how much you get in trouble at school and, like, your sheets and all that. And they're not really for me being naughty, they're for me not being able to do my work for most of them. The person that diagnosed me would tell all my teachers and they would actually understand.
After getting her tested and she was diagnosed with a language impairment, this allowed us to provide strategies for her to access the curriculum.
Usually we do a lot of essays in class, but now everybody else, when they do their essays, I get to do a slideshow, and it's really easy, I guess, and challenging sometimes.
Yeah, Leah always thought she had some sort of learning impairment, and I think the identification of her having a language impairment has taken a bit of pressure off her. She understands that now she can get the support that she's always wanted, and she can move forward in a positive way. Since she's been diagnosed, I think she's appreciated that she now has a diagnosis and it's identified that she needs support. She's been more positive, still has her moments, but the positive outcomes are more than the negative, outcomes for Leah.
Probably, like, I guess if I put my hand up to, like, come to me and do all my work with me, and actually, because at home when I do my homework it makes no sense, but I go to Mum and she reads me all the questions and she gives me an example, and it actually helps me to actually understand what I'm even doing. They could explain the work in a more technical way than just the basic, this is about this, and yeah. So it's like being positive and I guess not saying like, oh, I can't do it, like just keep trying. Well, I don't get as frustrated when I don't know the work. And I guess if I can't pronounce a word right, I just keep trying.
As I said, she's willing to participate in learning activities, she's giving stuff a go. She understands that there are expectations of what she needs to do, and she makes sure that teachers are aware of that.
Well, I do Maclet, and that's helped me with my pronunciation and my long and short sounds. And now words are starting to make sense. I used to just be able to read kids' books to my brothers, but now I'm starting to get into sort of in between child books and novels, but I'm not quite at novels yet.
But you will be soon.
Yeah.
So Leah's moving into Year 9 next year with access to the Disability Support Program. She has an NEP that clearly communicates strategies to teachers and documents smarter goals for her to work towards. Her mum is now able to apply for NDIS funding to provide further support and intervention for Leah. Leah's learning to read, is improving in her comprehension, and is navigating the school environment with less behaviour intervention. I used to spend a lot of time with Leah. And this success all started by understanding that behaviour is communication. Leah's behaviour was communicating she had a hidden language impairment.
Very powerful story. So I'm just going to very quickly in the next few minutes summarise for you the other component of our response to language impairment. So we've got the screening test this year that we're trialling, and we've also been trialling a new program developed by a speech pathologist in New South Wales, Dr. Julia Starling, who did her PhD on what's called the LINCS program. It's linking language to secondary learning. And we came across this in our search for an intervention program that would build capacity in staff to support the language impaired students at the Seaford Secondary College, because the teachers are the ones that spend the most time with the students and they have a unique opportunity to make a really big difference. So in the probe, it's a collaborative model which is supported by the research, and that's just a picture of it so you can see what we're thinking about. So in the randomised control trial that Julia Starling did for her PhD, she showed significantly increased use of language modification techniques by trained teachers. And students showed a significant improvement in written expression and listening comprehension. And it was the first investigation of a collaborative intervention that links changes in mainstream secondary teachers' instructional language practices with improvements in the language abilities of adolescents with language impairment. So we thought it was a really good fit for us, and we'd jump off the end of the jetty and give it a go. So that's what the program looks like. We decided to go for four teachers, mentoring four teachers, which I'm doing this term and another four next term. They're across subject areas. We have a weekly meeting. It allows them to really focus in on the modification techniques that I'm training them in. We look at their pre and post oral language use as we go through the program. We have follow-up surveys looking at their levels of use. Yeah.
Are those four teachers selected to target, say, a particular home group, or like, do they all teach?
They're subject teachers. So we have two science teachers who teach groups of Year 8 students. We had 12 teachers put their hands up to do the program when I presented it to the, at a staff meeting. And so we came up with a criteria because we could only do 8 this year.
It's across a range of students, yeah. So it's not just one class.
Okay.
It's
yeah. And also they're taking their learning to their learning area teams and sharing their learning. And the modified written resources that we've developed as a part of the program are going on the intranet and will be available to other teachers to use with their students. So we're creating a collective resource. And that domino effect, we now have the four teachers we've been working with this term who are coming to the end of the program and now sharing with their colleagues, which is great. So we target, we look at modifying teachers' oral language, written language, and we also focus on direct vocab instruction. And remember that research on vocab development I shared with you earlier, which really highlights the importance of doing this in the secondary curriculum. And we're always looking to modify the language, the complexity of the language, not the content. We also look at what we can do to make the environment more learner friendly. So I think we'll just skip on to, in your handouts, you'll have 12 terrific tips for teacher talking in secondary classrooms, and that's just some strategies that we work on during the program. We're looking at teacher oral language use. And I'll just give you that for your information so you have a bit of an idea. And that's adapted from Julia Starling's MINCS program. Keep going. This is an example of a recent assignment worksheet. And that was just a page of text. No colour, no visuals. It wasn't broken down into questions. It was a lot of information, and the actual assignment question was hidden in the body of text somewhere, and I struggled to find it. And we worked together to come up with that, and we've got some teacher feedback coming up. So there's some examples in your handouts, if you can read them. They're pretty small. Of the sorts of things that are covered in the program, just to whet your appetite. Why we target direct vocab instruction, remembering 90-95% of the words in a text need to be understood to comprehend what we're reading. And keep going. It's an example of keywords. So an important part of the direct vocab instruction in the program is I support the teachers using a range of strategies, including the might have heard tiers of vocab, must know, should know, could know words, to identify 10 key words that are important to understanding the content of the subject or topic they're teaching that term. We come up with those, we create descriptions rather than lexical dictionary definitions. We pair them with a visual to support comprehension, memory and learning. And those words are embedded in the topic content, worksheets, assignments, activities throughout the term. We test the students' knowledge of those 10 keywords before the topic starts and again at the end. And if we can move on to, there's a little graph. So week 8, we're coming to the end of the first group of four teachers doing the program. This is the first of those teachers that's been able to do the post topic vocab testing. A number of them are away due to illness. It's a special class at Seaford Secondary College. And the blue bar there shows the knowledge they had of the 10 keywords at the beginning, and the red bar shows the knowledge they had at the end.
And we scribed that for them because you would have heard me say at the very beginning, oral language competence develops ahead of written competence. So the way we capture their knowledge is really important too. So we were quite excited by that result, and we hope we have more robust evidence by the end of the year to demonstrate that trend.
And if you have a think about four teachers doing the program, it might not sound like much, but four teachers who teach six lines is 24 classes. That's potentially hundreds of students that were able to impact in comparison to a speech path working one-on-one with a student. So we've just put together some feedback from some of the teachers involved. One of the teachers is talking about the special class, but the other two teachers are talking about mainstream classes with students in them with language impairment.
It's made me think about how I deliver the content, how I get students to understand the content and give me different strategies to use. I've needed to go back to start with planning and focus on keywords and reinforce those keywords, use consistent language with the students, unpack my tasks and make my assessment tasks more accessible to students.
Beforehand, I would, I guess, to differentiate the work for the students to access it, I'd probably, dumb it down, give them something a bit easier, along the same lines, but a bit easier so they could access the information. When now, there's more scaffolding that I do to help them access exactly the same content as other children, so I don't feel like I'm dumbing work down for them. I'm giving them the skills to build up to it. To be honest, I actually always thought that if I had to look a lot at language and spelling and meaning of words and those things, it would take away from the curriculum. I wouldn't be able to finish my content. I'd be rushing because I'm spending all this time on language. But it's actually had the reverse. It's actually meant the kids have a much better understanding of the words that we're using, particularly with science. They're using them a lot more in their work as well, tests, in assignment planning, and in class discussions. And I'm finding that their quality of work has improved because we've done those groundwork with understanding what the words actually mean beforehand. So that's interesting, because I always thought that would take too long, but it hasn't. It's actually made us move through topics quite easily.
Whilst working with Christine, my pedagogy has definitely changed. There is a much more directed focus on vocab knowledge and also a lot of oral language as well, as there are several in my class that obviously really struggle with pronunciation. So I've been working really closely with the SSO on helping improve this. I've worked with this particular class for about 2 years now, so I have a really strong relationship with the kids, which has definitely helped. And I've found that the program, even the simplest things that you tend to forget as a teacher, like changing the layouts of the assessment tasks, has helped the students sort of clearly map where they should be on our timeline. And having timelines visuals is really, really important as well. Providing several ways of delivery, obviously we all know this is really, really important. So I've been working with the students' oral presentations as well, and looking at talking frames and sentence starters, and obviously using these within the classroom to help scaffold the process. And we've been doing the oral presentations in small groups, and obviously this has been really effective.
Getting some positive criticism of the way I deliver content to a class. It just allowed me to tweak certain strategies I've been using. It's allowed me to better understand that I do need to look at my assessment tasks and unpack them and make them more accessible to students, and that students can't access their curriculum unless they understand, you know, basic keywords.
Since I've been working with Christine, having that extra scaffolding, having that awareness he actually has just completed his first complete assignment on time, and he's looking at doing a presentation because we spoke about how he is more verbal, and as scary as it is to talk in front of people, that might be an option for him to get those higher marks so he can share what he's found verbally instead of on paper, and he's really excited about that.
She has been willing to participate in learning activities. She understands that when we do pre and post keywords testing, that it's not about the final result, it's about her improving from pre to post.
I would definitely recommend this program to all teachers. I obviously teach mainstream classes as well, and I think this would be just as beneficial. So it's really opened my eye that, you know, we need to continue to scaffold our assessments and make it much more individualised for each student. And also we definitely need to look into a lot of vocab instruction.
As teachers, we have to grow, and we have to come up with new strategies, and we need, with growing amount of students becoming identified as having a language impairment, we need to make sure that the curriculum is accessible to every student in class. And the LinQS program has provided strategies and ideas and methods to allow that accessibility. Christine's support, her willingness to help in unpacking the assessment tasks and providing resources, and clear and consistent and critical analysis of my teaching and how I deliver content.
It's a really good program. I actually have worked a lot on the practicals with science and the assessment tasks. It was interesting having Christine observe a prac, because I thought we were doing a really good job. and we were. And then when I showed her our prac sheet and Christine came up with all these other ways I can present the same information, the same words, I went home and we pulled apart the model and we took photos through each stage and we popped them on the sheet and the ticker boxes and everything, and the kids love that. It's so much easier. I don't have to keep repeating myself. They've got visuals there to help them. Everyone engages with it. And the assignments, I've changed the assignment to suit a variety of abilities. He has been very successful, and he hasn't had to ask me half the questions that he would normally ask. But at the same time, those students that are high achieving students have been able to work above other people as well. So they've actually been able to access stuff, information that's quite hard to understand, but having that scaffolding there, you know, I've got some that can work above higher independently, and then some who are a bit lower, but can still work independently, and they're both successful.
So I've been in a very privileged position of trialling this program at Seaford Secondary College with those four very generous teachers who were willing to jump off the end of the jetty with me. And it's been a real learning journey for both myself and the teachers, and a real enrichment of my practice in secondary schools, and I feel very lucky to have had that opportunity. Just in terms of the waves of intervention, I just thought I'd show you how what we're doing at Seaford fits with the waves model. So the language screening, the access to speech pathology service and the LINCS program, and where they fit. And just to wrap up, language impairment does pose a lot of challenges for us, but in our various roles, we're all in unique positions to make a difference and respond to that in ways that can improve outcomes for these young people. And we've shared some of those with you today. So thank you. Thank you very much.
And really quickly, a huge thank you, firstly to Christine, because I had all of the questions and none of the answers, and she was my go-to with the answers, and to Cez, because without Cez, none of this journey wouldn't have happened. It was Cez's vision that really started this, and her trust and belief in Christine and I to
be innovative and come up with, you know, new ideas and give them a go. So thank you both so much.
Thank you very much. We've talked a lot, I know we have, and we have as well, about the moral and ethical responsibility in driving learning improvement from very, very early years right through to post-school pathways. And we're in a really amazing position in that we can continue this journey and trailblaze further to maximise outcomes for students and young learners across the state.